For a long time, it was hard to imagine what, you know, what we were going to do. We thought we'd lost her. So ECMO and Iowa, to be honest with you, saved her life.
We got a call about Stephanie, and she was at an outside facility. And Stephanie had a very mysterious illness. To this day, we still don't know what that illness was. But we do know is that she was having a very difficult time oxygenating and ventilating. And despite being on a significant amount of ventilator support at the outside facility, she just wasn't improving.
They did a biopsy and couldn't find anything on the biopsy, and kind of gave us, you know, said, we're kind of out of options. We're gonna refer you to the University of Iowa. They told me that I had 12 to 24 hours to live, and so that's when I decided to transfer. So basically, the University of Iowa saved my life. I would not be here without them.
ECMO stands for extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, and what that means is it's the technology that allows us to remove blood from the patient's body, add oxygen to the blood, and then return it back to the body when the patient's lungs or heart are not able to manage that process on their own.
When we're evaluating a patient for ECMO, there's a lot of things that go into that decision of whether or not a patient can be effectively supported with ECMO, and there's two modes of ECMO. So in Stephanie's case, she was supported with venovenous or VV ECMO, which is just for respiratory support. There is a second modality or version of ECMO called venoarterial or VA, and that is cardiac and respiratory support. So in essence, she still is going through the motions of breathing. So she is doing inhalation and expiration. She still has the respiratory rate. She's still doing some gas exchange within her own lungs. Instead of having some nauseous ventilator settings, we can actually drop those down to a much safer level. So less pressure equals less potential trauma to the lungs. And so we can give her a minimal support to kind of keep her lungs open, but we take over the major job of the lungs, which is clearing CO2 and adding in oxygen.
ECMO traditionally has been used when all other modalities have failed, and that's certainly appropriate to the case we've been talking about. But in addition to that individual case, it has been useful for other patients that have failed all other modalities. We're also using it more now in a progressive way. Specifically, ECMO allows us to reduce the need for ventilators, which then allows us to reduce sedation, have patients be more awake while they're still critically ill, and participate in physical therapy, have patients that would otherwise be sedated and chemically paralyzed on a ventilator will actually be able to walk down the hallway with ECMO in place, communicate with families, and again participate in rehabilitation.
So we brought Stephanie in, and she came over on the ventilator, and then we put her on ECMO here at the university. However, we have the ability to actually go and get people both by ground transport as well as by fixed wing. We can send our team out, put them on ECMO, or take folks who are already on ECMO and bring them back on the fixed wing. So we have the ability to reach out and help in our surrounding community and then take care of them here at the university.
What sets Iowa apart in the ECMO program at UIHC is we're one of 36 adult ECMO programs in the country. We are also a two-time center of excellence through our governing body, ELSO, which is the Extracorporeal Life Support Organization. We have a very long-standing program since 1994, and we have some of the best survival statistics compared to other centers, international statistics, and we're always pushing to make ourselves better here in Iowa.
She could have been transferred anywhere, and looking back at everything that had to happen for her to make it, we're really thankful that she ended up at Iowa, because the ECMO program there is top-notch, and we really believe it saved her life.